I will speak about the origin of the Institute, the present, and our visions for the future. So I've enjoyed the book very much, and thank you to Henrik Knudsen for revealing this interesting history, of course, for me, personal interest, knowing more about the origin of the Institute and what was the driving forces behind them. I took great interest in studying it and can surely recommend it to you. I will try to bring up the historical line to the days, to nowadays, as I will look into the role for the institutes in gapping the bridging the gap from research to market. So, as we heard, throughout the 40s, 50s, and the 60s, a wide range of institutes were set up. You could say, as Klaus referred to, there were some people that were set out in a box to think outside the university, I think something like that. But they were addressing a broad range of technological fields of relevance to Danish industry and the society at all. And in 1973, the approved technological service system, which is abbreviated to GTS in Danish, was set up by law. This gave a common framework for the ATV Institute, together with the Danish Technological Institute and a number of other actors. About 30 entities were actually approved as GTS Institutes at that time. As we just heard Martin say, it was many interests were at stake in these days, in the following years. And through the 80s and the 90s, there were these quite heavy and at times brutal consolidations. And many of you present here knows the history of that far better than I will ever learn. So I will not go too deep into it. But since 2007, we had the 9 institutes as we know them today. The institutes span very broad in terms of technical fields, from high-end measurement and calibration to and advanced robotics and automation of production, and to agricultural techniques and growth methods. In total, the institutes today have more than 3,700 employees worldwide. The total turnover last year oversized 3.6 billion Danish kroner, and the R&D budget has increased by 100% since 2006 and now have overseas 1 billion Danish kroner. So, as you can understand, there has been a heavy development of the institutes, and they have truly grown out as independent children of ATV. In the consolidation, I don't think even Henrik Knudsen has full track of all the consolidations and mergers of the institutes, but I do know that Pioneer was established in 2003 as a part of the reconstruction of the former Biotechnological Institute, and the Danish Technological Institute has taken over a number of activities from some of the former institutes. But the three old boys in the GTS network, that is DHI, Force Technology and Delta, together incorporate between 12 and 15 of the former ATV institutes. Together, they hold about 65% of the turnover and of the employees. So, many changes have been made through the years, but I think it's fair to say, in the light of history, that the establishing of the GTS system was, as by law, was an official recognition of the pioneering work that ATV and others took out and secured an outreach activity from research to industry, an effort that has in these years are being intensified and boosted all over Europe as innovation is recognized as a key to restore growth and solve the grand challenges our societies are facing. Here, bridging the gap from research to market is crucial, and the Institute's role is more needed than ever. So, carrying this historical legacy, we have between the institutes we have set up a vision for the coming years and how to challenge the heavy challenges facing Europe and Denmark and Europe and the whole globe, as we have heard of today. We You saw this model earlier from Krusko Larsen, and as we see, the GTS working in the intersection between knowledge and market. On the one hand, we have the companies who create innovative products and services, and in order to maintain their market position in a still higher pace, they seek innovative solutions to their challenges. On the other hand, we have the universities are performing excellent research and offer science-based knowledge. They're spreading knowledge through education, conferences, articles, publication, etc. And I can truly say that, as also has been pointed out today, in Denmark we have excellent standing in these fields and there are very strong grounds to build on. In between, we see the role of the institutes. With the enormous growth of knowledge available and a still higher pace in technological development, we see ourselves as accelerating the business innovation by facilitating the meeting between knowledge and market. We secure the road to market through applied research, development projects, testing and counseling. It is our vision to be a key partner to Danish companies in the efforts to innovate. And in the years to come, we want to strengthen the cohesiveness of the knowledge system and secure that knowledge reaches the right users faster and easier than today, especially to the benefit of Danish SMEs. So this might be a little bit abstract, so we have set up four prioritized fields of action, which I will go into. The SME collaboration. As you can see on this chart, we have, the Danish economy is crucial to expand the innovation capacity of the SMEs in order to restore growth and to regain some of the more than 150,000 jobs that has been lost during the crisis. The Institute wants to consolidate the role as a preferred innovation partner to Danish SMEs. Today, we have approximately 20,000 individual customers a year, and from these, 13,500 has less than 50 employees. It is a very substantial number of companies, and actually it's approaching 10% of the total amount of Danish companies with more than one employee. But even though we believe that more can be done, one of our efforts goes to strengthen the collaboration with the other actors in the knowledge system. We do that in order to increase the knowledge uptake from university throughout the different institutions, like university, colleges, and vocational training here on the right side of the chart, so we can target even more businesses. So we see the GTS role bridging again and accelerating the knowledge spread and targeting even more SMEs. So, I thought it might be a little bit late in the evening, so I thought you could be tired of hearing only me. So I brought a testimonial from one of the customers at the Institute. So for even innovative companies can gain from collaborating with GTS. And here we have a firm that are producing swimming pool filter systems and collaborating with DHI. And there is no sound on this one. I just realized.
We realized this opportunity around 5 years ago. If we were capable of reinventing the way that water treatment is done in a public swimming pool, right from the pool to all the filtration step through the ventilation system, we could create swimming pools without the possibility of getting asthma and allergies, without the possibility of getting puring red eyes, and even people knowing chlorine is in the water. We use DHI, of course, to answer specific questions, to test specific equipment. That's crucial, of course. But the most important has been what we did not expect it, to meet the dedicated scientists at DHI, to work with them and colleagues around the world, to be part of networks in Denmark and globally, and also to have our ideas and our equipment integrated in large EU research programs.
Well, that was in Danish, but I think the most of you could understand if you could hear it. So, as you said, it's a pleasure to cooperate with DHI, and that brings them to new global markets and in the use of their facilities worldwide. This is our second effort is to strengthen the collaboration with the universities. We've heard today about the historical connection between the universities and the GTS institutes, and they are very strong. Also today, there is a broad variety and a vivid and insightful collaborations. And as stated again by Kroskar Larsen, the competences of the university and the institutes are supplementary. They're reaching from the excellent basic research at the university to the development and broad business interaction and knowledge dissemination of the institutes. It is crucial that we, in our knowledge system, secure that there is homogeneous collaboration and efficient utilization of the supplementary skills by the two sectors. By doing so, we can enhance strategic partnerships with a wide range of benefits to all parties. And I'm especially happy. The origin of many institutes, as mentioned, is from DTU. And this has fostered strong and deep collaboration. But and as a new step, I'm happy to be able to announce today that last week, University of Copenhagen and GTS signed a memorandum of understanding, setting up a framework for intensified collaboration on SME outreach activities from Copenhagen University, University of Copenhagen. Supplementary competencies on the two parties are key in the collaboration. Our third effort is on international outreach, and we have and we want to support the Danish industry in their globalization efforts. The GTS Institute, and especially the former ATV Institute, have undertaken a very strong international development throughout the last decade. Today, more than 50% of the Institute's commercial turnover comes from international clients, and the Institute's business has gone truly global. Some of the driving forces behind the internationalization are sketched in this chart. But again, to make it more specific, let me tell you about the activities in Singapore. Here, in 2007, DHI, in collaboration with Nanyang University, established a water and environment research center and education hub. The driver was to take part of the very high ambitions of the Singaporean government to create a global water knowledge hub, addressing both the local water supply problems as well at the same time to create global business opportunities. Today, DHI has a staff oversizing 2,000 researchers in Singapore and is planning for phase two of the center. Also, Force Technology has chosen to expand in Asia. Last month, they inaugurated a new maritime center at Singapore Polytechnics. The video here gives you a virtual tour. The core of the center is a brand new full mission ship simulator. It can simulate the operation of a container ship or likewise, and it's collaborating with up to four simultaneous pilot simulators, as we see here in the video. And the coupling of the up to five parallel simulators is a special force stronghold. It's accessible here in Lyngby, and now in Singapore. And the facilities are used for training and education purposes, but especially it will support and can and will support development activities for ships, equipment, and harbors, as they are still at a virtual stage. And you can see here, you can even simulate seasickness. If you're in the simulator, it's actually very, very authentic. So, you do get seasick by being there. And it simulates the weather, the wind, the current, and the tide, so you can have all thinkable possibilities in these simulators. But what is crucial for the more general DTS purpose is that both the DHI and the FORCE activities are used as springboards for Danish SMEs that want to reach out to the Asian markets. So that is why the larger perspectives of these activities going beyond the business activity of the individual GTS company. So as a theme of the conference today, we have the grand challenges and what it does to our society. I will no way try to go into the complexity and the depth of these challenges. I think the excellent presentations today has done it more than clear that we are challenged, heavily challenged, but again, with opportunities. So what I will say is that the institutes definitely have competences and specialities that can be utilized and activated in the tackling of these challenges. And it is our ambition to be a key player in the handling of the challenges, that be on a national, a European, or a global level. But we make no notions that we can do and that we have the golden key by ourselves. It's crucial that the challenges can only be met by intense collaboration from all parties in research, society, and industry. And again, to make it more specific, I will look into one area that we have gone into more depth with, on the challenge of aging population and the healthy living, and the needs to develop new technologies to cope with the caretaking needs. A cross-institute working group has been set up working with the telemedicine challenges. It has led to a number of initiatives, among other, we are advising a range of governmental bodies on the issue, and we are designed and developed several proposals for large national initiatives. Here, we focus on the development of health IT ecosystems encompassing both the supply side and the demand, so that they are both active partners in the sector. The initiatives are aimed at realization on a short range. That's how we work in GTS. And it's the target is to move Denmark beyond the pilot stage and into de facto mainstreaming of telemedicine activities to the benefits of companies. At the same time, the institutes are working on their individual fields of expertise also with telemedicine. And Delta has been working on a technical solution to this area as well. I'm challenged. Sorry, can you still hear me? So they have Delta has been working with technical solutions to the telemedicine challenge for a number of years. And especially, they have focused on establishing wireless systems for health monitoring and surveillance. And through the combination of advanced sensors, battery techniques, and microelectronics, they have developed the e-patch. And again, for demonstration purposes, allow me to show you that we're not only live transmitted on the net, the speaker's health is being surveilled by Svendborg Sygehus. So they can assure that I'm in fit condition. They're measuring my EKG, my ECG, my electrocardiogram, and I'm monitored directly. As you can see here, the green indicator. Ladies, bear with me. It is measuring my pulse, and we can be assured that I'm safe and sound, and I won't collapse on you here at the stage. So. Then again, a nice gimmick, but again with, of course, serious perspectives as we are working GTS. It is a device that can make major breakthroughs in the caretaking sector. I can stay at home being surveilled. My heart condition can be measured, and the device is very easy and it's comfortable to wear. I almost forgot it if I wasn't supposed to mention it in my speech. It can be kept on up to 3 days, and as I attend my daily activities. The e-patch can, to my smartphone, I'm surveilled at hospital. That will increase safety for patients and the feeling of safety. And it also opens a brand new possibilities for data capture, and from here, new fields of research. The platform is medically approved, it's flexible, and it can be acquired by companies and partners and adapted to their needs and products. That be systems for heart rhythm, blood pressure, temperature, oxygenation of the blood, and surveillance of epilepsy. The ePatch platform is an enabling technology which can help Danish companies capture the growing market of telemedicine. So let me conclude. With, on behalf of the GTS Institute, with the warmest wish of ATV, wishes to ATV, and all the distinguished members, and they wish you the warmest congratulations on the 75th anniversary. And it's my hope that we together can continue the journey, securing a sustainable, a prosperous development of our society on a strong technological foundation in the age of innovation. So, congratulations.